Good morning, and welcome to St. Anthony's of Padua. You are kindly requested at this time to turn off all electronic devices, including cell phones. Acknowledging God's presence among us, we commend our sister Dorothy to her final resting place with the Father. We encourage you to participate in this liturgy. The prayer responses for the liturgy can be found in the funeral books in the pews. Please stand and direct your attention to the entrance of the church, where Father will begin the opening rites of the liturgy. Our hope opening hymn is Christ Be Our Light.
Let us pray. Almighty God and Father, it is our certain faith that your Son who died on the cross was raised from the dead, the first fruits of all who have fallen asleep. Grant that through this mystery your servant Dorothy, who has gone to her rest in Christ, may share in the joy of his resurrection. We ask this through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Please be seated as we have our first reading from Scripture.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will provide for all peoples. On this mountain, he will destroy the veil that veils all peoples, the web that is woven over all nations. He will destroy death forever. The Lord God will wipe away the tears from all the faces. The reproach of his people he will remove from the whole earth, for the Lord has spoken. On that day it will be said, "Behold our God, to whom we looked to save us. This is the Lord for whom we looked. Let us rejoice and be glad that he has saved us." The word of the Lord.
Let us go rejoicing to the house of the Lord. Let us go rejoicing to the house of the Lord. Let us go rejoicing to the house of the Lord. Let us go rejoicing to the house of the Lord. I rejoiced when I heard them say, let us go to the house of the Lord. And now our feet are standing within your gates, O Jerusalem. Let us go rejoicing to the house of the Lord. Let us go rejoicing to the house of the Lord. For Israel's love is to praise God's name and there to give God thanks. There are set the judgment thrones for all of David's house. Let us go rejoicing to the house of the Lord. Let us go rejoicing to the house of the Lord. Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. May those who love you prosper. May peace ever reign within your walls and wealth within your buildings. Let us go rejoicing to the house of the Lord. Let us go rejoicing to the house of the Lord. For love of my family and love of my friends, I pray that peace be yours. For love of the house of the Lord of God, I pray for your good. Let us go rejoicing to the house of the Lord. Let us go rejoicing to the house of the Lord.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, if God is for us, who can be against us? He did not spare his own son, but handed him over for us all. Will he not also give us everything else along with him? Who will bring a charge against God's chosen ones? It is God who acquits us. Who will condemn? It is Christ Jesus who died, rather was raised, who also is at the right hand of God, who indeed intercedes for us. What will separate us from the love of Christ? Will anguish or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or the sword? No, in all these things we conquer overwhelmingly through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor present things, nor future things, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. The word of the Lord.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Jesus said, "A little while, and you will no longer see me. And again, a little while later, you will see me." Some of his disciples said to one another, "What does this mean that he's saying to us? A little while, and you will not see me. And again, a little while, you will see me. And because I am going to the Father." So they said, "What is this little while of which he speaks?" They did not know. And Jesus knew that he wanted to ask them, so he said to them, "Are you discussing with one another what I said? A little while and you will not see me, and again a little while and you will see me. Amen, amen, I say to you, you will weep and mourn while the world rejoices. You will grieve, but your grief will become joy. When a woman is in labor, she is in anguish because her hour has arrived. But when she has given birth to a child, she no longer remembers the pain because of her joy that a child has been born into the world. So you also are now in anguish, but I will see you again. And when I do, your hearts will rejoice. And no one will take your joy away from you." The Gospel of the Lord. On behalf of Deacon Ken and the entire parish family here at St. Anthony's, I'd like to extend to Dottie's family, to her daughters, to Carmi, to Joan, and to Lou, to her sister Winifred, her grandchildren, to Christine, Sean, Alicia, Damien, Juliana, to the great-grandchildren, and to the family and friends that are here, our deepest sympathy and our promise for our continued prayers. You know, it's a well-known fact that any time that we lose something, what we lose takes on an exaggerated value in our life, and it's true. You know, it seems like what we lose is less dispensable than everything else that we own. Let me give you a practical example, okay? You notice, take my glasses off, they don't go anywhere. What? Christmas. I got one of these gadgets around my neck so I don't lose my glasses. You get to be that certain age where the lenses are now progressive, and sometimes they're good when they're on, and sometimes they're good when they're off. Throw a pandemic in there, wearing masks and have them fog up all of the time, constantly laying my glasses down when I take them off. And I don't remember where I put them, and I go and I need them. Where are they? Well, you know where we're at. We're at St. Anthony. So what do we do when we can't find our glasses? We pray to St. Anthony, the patron saint of lost and found. And it's true, isn't it? It's true because when we lose something, it's always on our mind. It takes on that exaggerated value. Whether it's like my glasses, whether it's your keys, whether it's your credit cards, whether it's your cell phone, when you lose something, it's always on your mind until you're able to find it. Now, how much more is it true when it's not an object that we lose, but a person that we lose? Now, when I talk about losing a person, I'm talking about being with somebody, okay? So no matter how close a relationship you have with somebody, you have to part with them from time to time, because you can't have someone with you 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And partings can be painful, right? Because the longer the period of separation is, and the closer the relationship that you have with that person, the more that you feel that pain of parting. You know, it's been said that it's only when we have to part with somebody that we truly realize just how much that person means to us. Now, what is true of the ordinary partings in life is even truer of this parting that we call death, because death is the most irrevocable parting of all. And we know that Dottie will not be returning to us. And we feel that death comes quickly. It always does in every case. It doesn't matter if you die young, if you live to a ripe old age, if you die suddenly, or if you die after a long illness, death always comes too quickly. And the reason I say that is because we feel that it does, because we don't feel that we've always had the chance to say everything that's in our heart, to let that other person know exactly how we feel. And you know that Dottie loved all of you very much and felt that presence of your love in her life. Now, how do you describe Dottie, right? She's this little bundle of joy that came from the Midwest, that settled here with her Italian husband, Don. She's hardworking. She's accepting. She was content. She was content and grateful with what God had blessed her with. And she never complained, no matter what was going on. She never complained. Now, she was a perfectionist in some areas of her life, like in some areas of her cleaning and housekeeping, like especially making the bed, right? So she made the bed to a T. And it would not be past her to be in somebody else's house and to see a bed made. And if it's not made right, she'd go in and remake it just to make sure that the corners were just so. You know, she was a good cook, too. She was a good baker, made great. Those little palm crosses were always one of my favorites every year on Palm Sunday. You know, but she'd also could be able to help you, talk you through any recipe that you were having difficulty and that you needed help with. So when I hear about what people did for a living, I go back to, what was her name, Lily Tomlin, Irma Jean, you know? And, you know, she was a, you know, Dottie was a switchboard operator, you know, be able to connect people. So she worked for different places, and especially as she worked up at Lafayette College then too. And she always encouraged her girls to be able to make sure that they had a job, right? So they had to be working, had a job then too. And so a lot of times she'd even help them try to find a job and at Lafayette too. So I'm not sure if she did that so much because she wanted to inspire in you this great work ethic, or if she just wanted to make sure you weren't going to get into any trouble and she could keep an eye on you. Or maybe it was just a little bit of both. You know, but there's no question that her focus was on the family. She was always ready to go if family was involved. If there was something that involved the family, she'd be there. She was always the one who was there to talk to. If you needed to talk, you can go to Dottie to talk. She would be there if you needed somebody to take care of you. She'd be the one who'd be taking care of you. And she absolutely loved to be able to entertain her grandchildren and her great-grandchildren and would put up with whatever they wanted to do to make them happy because she loved them. You know, they would like to go different places. They'd like to go to the shore or other places as long as they could drive there, because there was no way they were going to get on an airplane to get anywhere. Now, of course, they were a Notre Dame fan, no question about that. You know, she did enjoy going to things like the sight and sound, you know, dinner. She liked going down to those plays and stuff like that. But when it came to the dinner, she did prefer to have somebody sit down and wait on her rather than going to a buffet. And of course, she always had to make sure that her hair was done every week with her appointment to make sure that she got that done. She was a woman of faith, no question about that. A woman of faith. She loved coming to the church. She loved receiving the Eucharist. And she would bring a smile to my face because I would see this little one, this little cutie just bopping up there. She's just coming, just bopping up there with the biggest smile on her face and couldn't help but just bring you joy every time that you would see her. And as a woman of faith, she was grateful to God for all of the many blessings that God had given her. But most importantly, she was just so grateful for the blessing of her family. You know, she, in whatever role she took on in her family, whether it be as a wife or a mother or as a grandmother or as a great-grandmother or anybody, any role that she would have, she would be supportive of you in whatever you were doing. But she was also a person who taught you how to be strong. If you were going to come and whine to her about something going wrong, she'd be able to give you that type of encouragement in no uncertain words, how you can get through it and how you can be strong. And I'm sure she did that because she knew where her rock was, and that was with God. But she was so grateful to her family. And you know, she loved you more than you probably can ever imagine. But on January 2nd, God called Dottie home. And today is the day that we have to part with her. And I think the most important thing to remember about today is that not all partings are devoid of joy. So in the midst of our sorrow, you still have to find joy. And I'll go back and give you another example. The example I give you is if you have your best friend, someone you see every day that you count on, that tells you that they got a new job, or you're in a new relationship, and they're going to move halfway around the world. How are you going to feel? You're going to feel lost. You're going to feel sad because I'm losing my best friend. But on the other hand, you're going to feel happy for what they are going to experience, right? So in the midst of our sorrow today, with our gift of faith, we still must find joy. And that's why I chose that reading that you heard today. You don't hear that reading very often. It comes from St. John's Gospel. It's not used as part of the regular 3-year reading, so you wouldn't hear it normally, but it is part of John's Last Supper discourse. So that means Jesus was speaking these words the night before he died to his disciples. And what does he say to them? You know, because they were plunged into such gloom at the thought of him leaving them. But he says, "You will have sorrow now, but I will see you again. And when I do, your hearts will rejoice." In other words, death will never be an everlasting parting. And our faith tells us that Dottie has not gone from us forever. She has not disappeared into nothingness. She does not cease to exist. She has merely departed to that other shore on the other side of life, that shore which is the final destination for all of us to share in someday. And we'll all be with Dottie again someday. But for now, we see her off, and we go with her as far as we are allowed. So we bid her farewell today with our prayers and with our love, because Dottie has gone to the better things, to be with the Lord forever. For those who die in grace go no further than God, and God who loves us and comforts us is always very near to us. Please stand. My brothers and sisters, Jesus Christ is risen from the dead and sits at the right hand of the Father, where he intercedes for his church. Confident that God hears the voices of those who trust in the Lord Jesus, we now join our prayers to his. Lord, hear our prayer. Lord, hear our prayer.
Many friends and members of our families have gone before us in the way of the kingdom. Grant them an everlasting home with your Son. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Many people die by violence, war, and famine each day. Show your mercy to those who suffer so unjustly, these sins against your love, and follow them to the eternal kingdom of peace. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Lord, hear our prayer.
The family and friends of God seek comfort and consolation. Heal their pain, dispel the darkness and doubt that come from grief. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We are assembled here in faith and confidence to pray for our sister God. Strengthen our hope so that we may live in the expectation of your Son's coming. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Lord God, giver of peace and healer of souls, hear the prayers of the Redeemer, Jesus Christ, and the voices of your people, whose lives were purchased by the blood of the Lamb. Forgive the sins of all who sleep in Christ, and grant them a place in the kingdom. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated. Please stand. Pray, my brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. As we humbly present to you these sacrificial offerings, O Lord, for the salvation of your servant Dorothy, we beseech your mercy that she, who did not doubt your Son to be a loving Savior, may find in him a merciful judge who lives and reigns forever and ever. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. In him, the hope of the blessed resurrection has dawned, that those saddened by the certainty of dying might be consoled by the promise of immortality to come. Indeed, for your faithful Lord, life is changed, but not ended. And when this earthly dwelling turns to dust, an eternal dwelling is made ready for them in heaven. And so with the angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim.
Thank you.
You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it. He gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly, we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, Alfred, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember your servant Dorothy, whom you've called from this world to yourself. Grant that she, who was united with your son in a death like his, may also be one with him in his resurrection. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil, and graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you." Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Yeah.
Please kneel. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter into my room, but only say the word and my soul shall. Communion, we will start with this side first, coming single file. If there is anyone here who is unable to come forward at this time but would like to receive communion, just raise your hand, and when I'm finished, I'll be happy to come back to you in your seat. But for all of you here that are unable or unprepared at this time to receive the Eucharist, I'd like to pray for all of us now, a prayer of spiritual communion. My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament, and I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there, and I unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you.
Thank you.
Please stand. Lord, whose Son left us in the sacrament of his body food for the journey, mercifully grant that, strengthened by it, our sister Dorothy may come to the eternal table of Christ, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Before we go our separate ways, let us take leave of our sister. May our farewell express our affection for her. May it ease our sadness and strengthen our hope. And one day we shall joyfully greet her again, when the love of Christ, which conquers all things, destroys even death itself. Into your hands, Father of mercies, we commend our sister Dorothy, in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, she will rise with him on the last day. And we give you thanks for the blessings which you have bestowed upon Dorothy in this life. They are signs to us of your goodness and of our fellowship with the saints in Christ. Merciful Lord, turn toward us, listen to our prayers, and open the gates of paradise to your servant, and help us who remain to comfort one another with assurances of faith, until we all meet in Christ and are with you and with our sister forever. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. In peace, let us take our sister to her place of rest. May the angels lead you into paradise. May the martyrs come and welcome you and take you to the holy city, the new and eternal Jerusalem.